But you have English family, and we are family, and so I don't stand here as a stranger. In fact, I'm going to skip the first part of what you normally call people that visit your church for the first time. I'm not going to be a visitor. I'm just going to jump right into being family, even though it's my first time. And I'm keeping you on your feet because we're going to pray. And I'm going to have you pray because I discovered something a long time ago. There is nothing faulty with this book. There's nothing wrong with the Word of God. It works. It works in every circumstance. It works in every situation. God's Word does not return void. God's Word is powerful and effective. But I'm 42 years of age and I was preaching since I was 21, and I've discovered something. I've discovered that though God's Word is not faulty, our soil is. And every time someone opens the Word of God, they fling seed out. And depending on the soil and the condition of your soil depends on how effective that seed becomes. So I know we've worshipped, and I know we've lifted our hands, and I know we've applauded heaven, but I want you just to take a moment to deal with your soil. I don't want anyone in here to waste a seed that God wants to fling into your marriage and into your life and into your circumstance. I don't want you to leave here with so much hardness of soil that the seed bounced off when it should have gone straight in. And so you have to take care of your soil. You have to just take a few moments to pull out the weeds of distraction. Take a few moments to shake off the weariness of the day. Take a few moments to remove the disappointment that is on the top level of your soil right now. And just understand that what we're about to do is a life-changing part of our service. Anything we do week in, week out, we take for granted sometimes. We become familiar with. So it's good for us to stop and understand people gave their life for this book. Our ancestry is in this book. And there's wisdom for your life in here tonight. So Father, we come with grateful hearts for this book. For your words that are words of life to those that feel they are dying. Your word that is a lamp unto our feet when we feel like we don't even know what step to take next. Your word that is truth when we honestly can't remember when someone last spoke truth to us. Your word that stands the test of time when so many other people's words have not. Your word that is faithful when we are faithless. Your word that has life and breath for our spirit. God, this word, we ask that the seed of this word tonight would fall into the soil of our hearts and it would find there a place to take root. That God, we would not waste the seed tonight. We would collect it. We'd be so hungry for it. We would devour it as it falls. That God, we would be women of your word. We know how to worship you in spirit and in truth. So God, I pray over my sisters in this room this evening. God, give them the seed they need. And now, God, I pray I will get out of the way so that you can have your way. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You may take your seats. It is my privilege to be here for this evening, and I've been looking forward to coming to seeing what El Paso women look like. And you do not disappoint. I have heard great things. This church has an incredible, incredible legacy and spoken well of around the world. Your pastor Pastor Charles is very, very loved around the world. His word ministry, so respected around the world. And so it's an honor to be here and to get to open the word. And I want to speak to you tonight about something that is a journey for me that I went through. You know, sometimes we go through things, and I've discovered that usually when you're going through things, that's not the time to talk about them. Because when you're going through some stuff, you feel some stuff that's not necessarily good stuff. And often our feelings would like to be heard before we've had time to process. And so for me, this message was something that happened to me in my very early days in ministry, something that could have stopped me ever getting up to do ministry, something that could have shut down my dream before my dream ever had become alive, something that could have closed me down in my asking and in my imagining. And with the conference theme being on asking, imagining, and dreaming, I am pretty sure there are people in this room right now that don't dare to dream because of what others may say. You don't dare to ask because all your life you've been told, don't be so ungrateful. You don't dare to imagine that your life could look any different than it does right now. Well, I was in a season of my life when I was stepping out, baby stepping out, to believe that God was calling me to do something. I was 19 years of age, and I had begun to discover that God wanted to use me to communicate, and the person that was the most shocked about that fact was me. I was not the girl that wanted the microphone. I was the girl that was happy behind the scenes. I wasn't someone that wanted to get up front. I was happy sorting out. I ran conferences like this and happily did so without anyone knowing I was there. So when God began to speak to me about stepping up and opening my mouth, I was very nervous, but I realized that I better do as I was told. I was more in fear of God than man, so I said, okay. And it was announced in our church to a small group, probably only 100 women were gathered at the time. And I remember getting up as it was announced that Charlotte's going to start a Bible study for women. And I was so nervous. I get, when I'm nervous, those nervous rashes. Does anyone else get them? Like mine begins here, and if I'm really nervous, goes all the way up here till my whole face is covered. Well, my nervous rash was on high alert, and I remember getting up and being super nervous to tell the women what I was going to try and do, and I was opening my mouth. I was beginning to imagine what could happen. I was beginning to imagine. I was beginning to dream, and so I began to say, this is what I'm going to do. And as I was speaking, there was three women on the third row back that were elders' wives in the church at the time. Older than me, wiser than me, been around longer than me. And as I'm speaking, they began to mutter amongst themselves. And I thought to myself, naively now, I realize, wow, I'm so glad they're about to give me an amen. And I could do with an amen right about now. And so as they were muttering, I'm thinking they're going to help set me up confidence and give me some courage. But what happened next took the wind out of my sails, and I could not believe it. Because what they did next was, as I was speaking, they began to audibly boo out loud. And then one of them stood up that had been chosen to be the ringleader and said out loud in front of the other 100 women gathered, if you are leading, thank you. That's not what they said. I wish. She got up and she said, if you are leading anything, then we are not coming. And all of her little friends got up with her and walked out the door of the church. Elders' wives, older than me, been in the church longer than me. And as I'm beginning to dream about stepping out to do something, my dream, as it were, was pulled down by those that I thought would build me up. And in that moment, I thought to myself, oh God, is this what it looks like to be in your family? Is this what it looks like to be in the church? Are we as dysfunctional as the world? Are we as jealous of one another as we find in the workplace? Are we envious of one another's gifts and talents when you've given us all gifts and talents? Is there not enough confidence in us to realize somebody else is stepping up does not mean we have to step down? Have we not been able to see, God, that you're bigger than this? I didn't realize that day that that my stepping up would make them feel insecure. I didn't realize that day that my dream would intimidate their dream. I didn't realize that day that my imagining and my asking of God would somehow make them feel that I should sit down and be quiet, like I'd overstepped a mark. And so that day I went home and I began to question. I said, God, I told you I'm not called to this. God, I told you I didn't want to do this. And as I sat there thinking about my options, I seriously considered never standing up, never teaching the word again, never announcing to anyone what was going on in my heart. And I remember at that moment having to decide, do I dare? Do I dare to believe that God is speaking to me? And if I do, am I willing to take whatever opposition is in my way to get to a place where God can use me? And I determined that day at 19 years of old, I will never do what those women did to me. I determined that day that when it was time to speak about it, that I would speak about it in a way that would help women see, let's not be those kinds of sisters. Let's not be that kind of church. Let's not be those kind of people, because we need a fresh revelation in the church of what it is to set one another up to win. And if you want a title for what I'm talking about tonight, I'm talking about what it looks like for us to set each other up to win, to set each other up to win generationally, to set each other up to win as sisters, to set each other up to win when we might have the same gifts and talents. Our job as the church is not to pull one another down. Our job is to build one another up to win. And yet I look through my Bible and I find it really hard to find stories where that was the case. I read of David, who stepped out and dared to dream he could take down a very big giant. And on the sideline, the very ones that should have cheered him on, his own family, were the ones who whispered in his ear, "Who do you think you are?" And maybe you're here and you have a similar story, that when you've stepped up to your giant, those that you thought would before you seem to somehow be against you, and it's made you live in fear of taking the next move. Well, I want to encourage you tonight to pick the stone up and take the giant down. I look at Joseph. He didn't ask to wear a colorful coat. His dad gave it to him. He didn't ask to be the special one. It just happened. He didn't ask for the dream. God gave it to him. Yes, maybe he could have been wiser how he shared it. But the fact is, God was calling him and setting him up to do something. But his own brothers hated the sight of him, threw him in a pit and said, "We don't want anything to do." They didn't understand one day they would need their brother. They would need him in his success. They would need him in his position of power. But they couldn't see past their own insecurities. And so they discarded what God had sent to bless them. And there's so many times that we discard the very blessing God has sent us for our future. And I don't want to be in a church where we can't generationally set one another up to win, where we can't see the bigger picture that God sees for the future. And so I am committed in my life, wherever I have an opportunity, to use my voice to celebrate what God wants celebrating, to open my mouth for those that feel they need someone to say words over them. This whole conference has been done to set you up to win. It's free. Hello. They're not doing this because they've got nothing else to do. They're creating an environment for you to come in so you can dream bigger, go for it, believe greater, step out of your comfort zone. So I searched my Bible and I searched my Bible and I eventually came across one story. One that I thought, well, if there's ever a picture of what I think this should look like, these actually two women modeled this. And what I love about this story is that these two women represented two generations. In a time when so many seem to be struggling to transition in seasons of their life, this story shows us so beautifully what it takes. And the story is of Ruth and Naomi. The context of this story is that Naomi is in a terrible season of life. Awful things have happened to her. Hard things have happened to her. Naomi has lost her loved ones. She has lost her closest family. She's now a widow, and now she has lost her sons, and she finds herself with nothing and no one around her, and she feels like she so somehow has missed it. She so somehow feels worn out by life that she even says, I'm going to rename myself. And she announces to those around her, don't call me Naomi anymore. That's not who I am. She says, call me bitter, because bitterness is the season of life I find myself in. And I don't know who in the room this evening has renamed themselves bitter. But I know you're here tonight. I know you've gone through a season where you feel like, where are you, God, and what is going on? Where you feel like no one seems to know the pain I am going through. And you said, I don't even want to be known for the person I was because my life has such a bitter taste to it. It's in the seasons of life where we are identifying with pain and bitterness that you really find out who is for you. It's in that season of life that you actually really find out who's got your back. Because when she had nothing to offer anyone, that's when the one person stepped up that said to her, I am going to set you up to win. See, the enemy doesn't want us to discover the voices in our life that want us to win. Because imagine for a moment, if every voice in your world right now, from the moment you woke up to the moment you lay your head on your pillow, every voice in your life, all they wanted you to do was win. Imagine if when you woke up, your kids were setting you up to win, telling you you should win. Imagine if that was your marriage day in, day out. Imagine if that was how your co-workers spoke to you. If everyone in your world was setting you up to win, how bigger would you dream? How many more crazy ideas would you come up with? Because everyone around you like, yeah, let's do it. Imagine just the possibilities that you would go to bed at night and contemplate, because this is win-win all around me. That's why the enemy doesn't want this in the church. He doesn't want those voices in your ear, because he doesn't want you to find someone who will pick you up and move you to where God is calling you. And we have to find our voice for one another, to spot the one that's going through the season where our head is downcast and our heart is heavy and the weight of the world seems to be on her shoulders, and we need to be able to see her. And when we see her, we need to know our job is to go and put words of life within her. Our job is to go and help her stand back up with words that bring back to life that which circumstances have tried to kill. And I think the first thing we have to commit to, if we want this ethic in our churches of setting one another up to win, is we have to flip something on its head that our modern world has handed us. See, we live in a world where everybody talks about being connected. Have you heard that? Oh, I'm connected to so-and-so, and I know so-and-so, and I have this many friends on Facebook, and I have all these fake friends on Twitter, and I am so connected. And I'm going to go to that conference and I'm going to get so connected. And everyone's going to give me their card and I'm going to have all their names and we're going to be so connected and I'm going to be so set up. No, no, no. Something about our world that has flipped it around from the way God intended it to be, because connections will not save you, but commitment will. God's not asking us to get more connected. God is asking us to get more committed. And in a time when your life is bitter, in a time in your life when it's hard, it's those that are committed to you that show up. Not your connections. Your Facebook friends are not going to show up. Hello, newsflash. Because they've got too many friends on Facebook to show up for you all. I mean, you got to find those ones that, I mean, when they say it, they mean it. When they say they love you, they actually mean they love you, even when you're hard to love. Those that are committed to you, for good, bad, and ugly, But we've made our words so cheap. We've made our language so easy to detach from. We say, I'm committed to the church, but what we mean is, until you play songs I don't like. And then I'll go and connect somewhere else. We say, I'm connected, I'm committed to the church, but don't ask me to give my money. So we have a level that suits us, but I tell you, God is looking for those that are willing to use words and have values of commitment. I've been in the same church all my life. I've been there 42 years. I've been on the same team for 27 years. I've been with the same man for 24 years. Commitment is not easy. Commitment is hard, but commitment is what sets other people up to win. When they know you're there, when they know you've got your back, when they know you'll be there next Sunday like you said you would. And in a time where Naomi feels bitter, there's two responses. Orpah, one of the daughter-in-laws, she says, I'm going to go back. This was a good connection. Thank you for the season of life that our connection was for, but I'm going back. But Ruth, she wasn't connected to Naomi. She was committed. And Ruth said these words, don't urge me to leave you, Naomi. And don't tell me to turn back from you. Because where you go, I will go. And where you stay, I will stay. And your people, they're going to be my people. And your God is going to be my God. And where you die, I will die. And may the Lord deal with me, be it ever so severely, if even death separates you and me. That is what you call someone setting you up for winning. Imagine, just imagine for a moment. Imagine Naomi with her head down and her heart heavy and a long journey ahead, not knowing what it would bring or who it would bring, but walking in this journey in the heat of the day and stopping for a moment as Ruth took her head and lifted her so she could look in her eyes. And she began to speak these words over her. Don't tell me to leave you. Where you go, I go. Where you stay, I stay. And as she began to say line after line, I imagine Naomi's spirit began to rise. I imagine something on the inside of her that was dying began to come back to life. I imagine that her head began to be lifted and she began to see there was a future because she realized someone is committed to seeing me succeed. Someone is committed to seeing me end my life, not bitter, but better. I need to tell some of you, you've got to open your mouth. Stop sitting on your words of encouragement. Stop closing your mouth thinking, well, everybody tells her she's great. No, you tell her she's great and mean it when you say it. Don't keep your mouth closed when your daughter is around you. Put words in her that set her up to win. Don't just moan at your mother. Tell her, thank you for being my mom and set her up for win. Don't be silent when your friend is going through crisis because it's too difficult to know what to say. Let her know, I am praying for you. I've got you. I'm here if you need me. Put your mouth into action and help set someone up to win. If we're going to set each other up to win, our commitment must precede connection. Jesus said to a group of young guys, follow me. That's not a lot of information. Follow you where? Where are we staying? Are there any perks to this job? Will I get a benefits package? Will I get a private donkey? You know what Jesus was doing? He was looking for commitment before connection. He said, follow me. And if you'll commit to that, If you'll commit to me with only that being said, if you'll leave everything and begin to come on a journey that you know nothing about, if you'll do that, then I think there's something in you that I can work with. But if you need to know all of the small print before you'll even connect to me, then I don't think you're going to stand by me when there's a cross. And I don't think you're going to hang around when they're stoning. It says that they carried on and journeyed a little further, and they eventually came to Naomi's hometown. Ruth said, "Hey, Naomi, take a nap. I'm going to go out and I'm going to find us food. I'm going to set us up to win." She goes out and she finds a field, and she ends up in a field, and the guy that owns it is a guy called Boaz. Boaz begins to show favor to Ruth. He likes the look of Ruth. And he says to his servants, "Make sure you leave her plenty of food behind." And all of a sudden, she finds herself in a field of favor. You know what I've discovered? God has fields and fields and fields of favor. But you know what else I've discovered? Favor is a great revealer. Favor can be intoxicating. Favor can make you all excited that you did something so great. Look what I have made happen. Favor is a revealer this way. Favor will either reveal your faithfulness or your forgetfulness. Favor will either reveal that you are not in it for yourself or that you indeed were in it all along for yourself. I've watched so many people step into a field of favor and suddenly forget why they're there or with whom they're supposed to be there. Step into a field of favor in business or opportunity, in gift and talent. Step into a favor field where there's all kinds of things they can now do, and suddenly they forget who helped put them there in the field and who's waiting for them back home that needs food. Favor is very dangerous. It can cause people to fall and to fail. And that's why God needs you to remember that any favor that is on your life, you must be faithful with it. See, I've heard people say that favor is not fair. I don't believe that. I believe this. Favor is fair as long as favor is shared. If you share the favor on your life, it is entirely fair. If you share the favor on your life, whatever the gift or talent is, hey, if you're the world's best baker and you share the favor on your life and give me a cupcake, it is fair. But if you keep it to yourself and die with the secret recipe, it is not fair. And when you understand that, you don't mind if someone in the church gets a $1 million contract and you don't. Because if they remember and if their faithful, favor will be shared with the kingdom of God and the house of God and the things of God. And when God realizes that you are not forgetful, but you are faithful, God keeps giving you more favor and more favor and more favor, because he knows it's not about you, it's about him. And if we're going to set each other up to win, we've got to remember any favor that is extended to us, God is entrusting us to be stewards of. And it was just like God to remind her in her field of favor. It's like this little conversation that happens that I just smile that God had made happen. Because as she's gathering, it says she can't even gather all the grain that has been left for her. And then she's invited to a private dining room to eat the food that has been prepared. And as she eats, it says she begins to put pockets in her pockets, food to take back to Naomi. While she's being pampered, she's aware of the one at home that she's here for. And then it says this. She asks Boaz in verse 11, "Why are you showing me so much favor?" And Boaz says this, "I have been told about what you have done for your mother-in-law. I've been told how since the death of your husband, you have left your own father and mother and your homeland, and you've come to live with a people who you did not know before. And so may the Lord, may he repay you richly and favor you highly for what you have done." In other words, Boaz is saying, just in case you forget, The reason all this favor is here is because of all your faithfulness over there. And while ever that stays, this will only get better. We as the people of God need to understand we're not competing for blessing, but we are stewards of blessing towards one another in the house together, that what you bring home blesses me and what I bring home is supposed to bless you. It says as she progresses and goes out and collects the food every day, that Boaz increasingly thinks, hello, she's cute. And it's like Ruth is totally clueless. So now it's time for Naomi to set Ruth up to win. So Naomi comes and says, hey, can we have a word? She says, sure, what do you want me to do? She goes, oh, no, I'm going to help you. Going to help me? Yeah. You know that Boaz guy? Yeah. He likes you. likes you. Like, this is good. And he says, Ruth's like, really? And then it goes on to tell us how Naomi begins to say to her, okay, this is what you're going to do. Naomi began to say to her, this is what you should wear. This is the custom that goes on in the household. And this is the time of day when you should approach Boaz. And when you approach him, she even says, don't talk over him when he's with his friends. Just wait, there'll be a moment. And when you go, this is how to present yourself, and this is where you should lay down. Because if we're going to set each other up to win, we have to position each other properly. There's so many people in the church that fold their arms and sit back and watch that young girl fall. Others that sit back with judgmental words saying, have you seen what she's up to? Others that happily would wag a finger but would not go and take her hand and say, hey, let me set you up to win. Hey, let me help you. I also went through a divorce. And I don't like talking about it, but I can see the pain you're in. And I can position you well for your future. If I were you, I wouldn't talk about the kid's dad that way when he's not around. If I were you, I would hold those feelings. I know they're valid. I know you're hurt, but it's not going to help the children. It's not going to help you move on. If I were you, I would really get some help. Get some counseling, move over. Because I never had that. No one helped me. I muddled through. I made it by the skin of my teeth. I made it. But I tell you, I don't want you to have the same pain. If I can position you well, let me introduce you to someone. Hey, I see you're starting a business. Man, that's hard. I remember when I started a business. Let me help position you. Hey, I have a great person that can. Hey, I see you're thinking of joining the worship team. It's kind of scary when they all know each other. Let me tell you how I joined and what happened. And we come down off our platform, as it were, to find the one that needs to get up with us. And we say, I don't want you to fail up there. See, imagine if those women, when I stood up as a 19-year-old girl, had said, oh, baby, I can see your red rash. Next time, wear a turtleneck. Hey, you know what? You don't need to preach so long on your first time. Just give them a good 5 minutes, and they'll come back for more. I wished that in those moments when there was no one to position me properly, someone would have stood up, because they could have. There were people there that had done what I was doing. There were people there that knew what it was to be scared. There were people there that knew that I was trembling on the inside, but no one positioned me well. And we must commit to position one another well. It says that when David found out he would not get to build the house of God, he was disappointed. I imagine there was a moment when he was like, God, that's not fair. I fought all these battles. I've been faithful, but God, now I don't get to build the dream. But you know what David did? He said he made a decision. I'm going to set Solomon up to win. He's young and he's inexperienced. I have all these friends that owe me something. I'm going to use my favor and I'm going to ring my friends that are woodcutters and craftsmen, and I'm going to take care of resources and finances. I'm going to set Solomon up to win. And you know what I believe? I believe when Solomon stood under an open heaven and God said, "What do you want?" I think he went in his mind, "I don't need money, Dad took care of that. I don't need craftsmen, Dad took care of that. I don't need a staff, Dad took care of that. God, the only thing left to ask you for is wisdom, because I have so been set up to win." But oftentimes I think we stand under open heaven asking for a whole load of stuff that was three rows back. It was in the woman next to us. It was in the person down on the other aisle. We've got to be willing to position one another properly. Amen. And finally, and this is the best part, it says that Ruth, because she took Naomi's advice, she got the guy. She married Boaz. And she became pregnant with a baby. She had the baby, and it says in Ruth chapter 4 that the baby was born, and listen to this. It says, the baby was born, and the women said to Naomi, "Praise be to the Lord, who this day has not left you without a guardian redeemer. May he become famous throughout Israel. He will renew your life and sustain you in your old age for your daughter-in-law, who loves you and is better to you than seven sons," that'll preach, "has given him birth." Listen, then Naomi took the child in her arms and cared for him. And the women living there cried out, "Naomi has a son. Naomi has a son." Wait a minute. Naomi didn't have a son. Ruth had a son. But see, what God needs you to see is that her win is your win. And your win is her win. Her win is your win, and your win is her win. And if we could understand, if we could absolutely get this down in our spirit, if we could understand that we are not fighting for the same thing, we are not fighting over one prize, but God has good stuff for all of us, that God has a lane for all of us, and God just asks us to set each other up to win, that we are actually, if we're going to be one sisterhood, we've got to actually change our posture and pick each other up. We've got to come alongside each other. We've got to open our mouth more. So all across the room, I want you to stand to your feet. See, we came in here, many journeys, many stories, lots of stuff going on. And to be honest with you, when the enemy looks at a room like this and sees what I see right now, he's not that scared. And I'll tell you why. Because right now, it would be easy to pick one off. It would be easy to push one of you over. It would be easy for one of you to go missing in the crowd. But here's what it looks like when you set one another up to win. I want every single person to join hands across this room with no aisles left open. Now this is what the enemy is scared of. Because where there was a gap before, there is no gap. Where there was a woman on her own with no one at her side, now there is someone attached to her. Where there was someone that could have been flicked off, now if they try, that woman on the left and right will pick her right back up. When the gaps are closed in the church, when the gaps are closed in the generations, this is what frightens the enemy. And this is why he does not want you to believe this message or go home and work out this message, because he can't fight this. He can't come against this. You are a force when you join and you stand together. You are a force when you set one another up to it. That is what the body of Christ is supposed to look like, and that's why the enemy is very happy for denomination to turn against denomination and group to turn against group, because we do his job for him. But this is where we have to open our mouth. This is where we have to share our favor. This is where we have to be committed, not just connected. This is where her win is your win.